I welcome you to the first MHS Monsoon Musing of 2020. My name is Amruta Tayodekar and I'm a research associate with the Maritime History Society. Before we begin, I would take this opportunity to brief you about the society. A brainchild of late Vice Admiral M.P. Awathi, the Maritime History Society is a premier research organization where all enthusiasts in maritime affairs can learn about the richness and diversity of Indian maritime history and heritage. MHS, in its constant endeavors, aims to promote outreach activities through its educational programs and maintains an interim naval heritage gallery at our premises at Fort Mumbai. Due to the pandemic and the lockdown that follows, MHS operations have become largely digital and technology friendly. MHS conducts a series of monsoon lectures every year during the monsoon. This series is renamed Monsoon Musings based on an earlier compilation done by the previous curator, Commander Mohan Narayan. Before we start, let me accustom you with the Zoho platform on which we've all gathered. Knowing a few things will help us interact better and get the most out of today's talk. There is a Q&A tab to the left of your screen. Once you click that, a chat box will open. You can use that to ask your questions. In case you log out of the session, you can re-log in from the same link that you have received. All attendees have been kept on mute. To view the screen better during the presentation, click on the camera icon to turn off the video. The program for the day is as depicted. This is the first of an annual commemorative talk in the memory of the 14th Chief of Naval Staff and our former Chief Patron, MHS, Admiral J.G. Nadkarni, on his death anniversary. We are glad to announce an essay competition in his memory for the first time this year. The theme for the essay competition is Reflections on the Indian Nautical Knowledge, Past, Present, and Ways Ahead. I now invite Director MHS, Commodore Audical Johnson, to introduce the event and the topic. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Amruta. Welcome to members, friends, patrons, and supporters of Maritime History Society. Allow me to go straight into introducing the legend whom you see on the screen. Born on 5th December 1931, Jayant Ganpat Nadkarni completed his cadets training on board the T.S. Dufferin and was selected to join the Royal Indian Navy in March 1949. He completed his training at UK at the Royal Naval College, Dartmouth, and during this time earned the endearing nickname of Podgy, by which he continued to be called amongst his peers. He grew into the higher echelons of Indian Navy with excellence in navigation, operations, and aircraft direction, and sailed through a range of staff operations and command tenures till taking the helm of fine Indian Navy on 1st December 1987 as its 14th Chief of Naval Staff in the rank of Admiral. Earlier, when he was a Chief of Staff, Western Naval Command, he endorsed the then Rear Admiral Manohar Prahlad Awati's vision to start Maritime History Society and thus became a founder trustee. From 2002 till 2016, he was the chief patron of the society and steered many studies in navigation and nautical subjects. On a personal note, we did have a perceptive difference on an issue of 18th century naval operations in the Bay of Bengal for a very, very brief moment. But then he went on to mentor my maiden work of Legacy of Royal Indian Navy during World War II, which got published as a book, Timeless Wake. Admiral Nadkarni remained a constant source of encouragement till his sad demise 2 years ago. Based on a conversation with the family, and as approved by our trustees, an annual two-part commemoration is being launched today to salute the work and vision of late Admiral J.G. Nadkarni. Today marks the first of an annual series of commemorative lectures. And later this month, an annual essay competition in his memory on a nautical theme will be announced to encourage study and writing by young mariners and college students. We are honored that the first person of eminence to deliver the inaugural Admiral J.G. Nadkarni Memorial Lecture is a son of the legend himself, a navigator and now a serving flag officer, Rear Admiral Ravindra Jayant Nadkarni, Flag Officer, Offshore Defense Advisory Group, has himself undertaken a maritime passage through a number of significant navigational operations and command tenures in the Indian Navy. An avid yachtsman, he was part of a tri-service sailing expedition on board INSV Samudra on a round-the-world sailing voyage in 1988-89, and he'll probably mention it. On attaining flag rank, he was the Chief Staff Officer Operations, Western Naval Command, then moved through the flag assignments of Flag Officer Doctrine and Concepts, Flag Officer Karnataka Naval Area, and Chief of Staff Southern Naval Command before his present assignment. Literally, he has covered a swath of the Konkan Malabar coast. It is very significant for us at Maritime History Society that in the midst of a major research work titled Indian Nautical Knowledge, today we have Rear Admiral R.J. Nadkarni share a professional talk on navigation methods of ancient mariners. He has agreed to take on questions in a brief moderated session with the online audience. As he gets set, may I remind you once again that on the bar on your left is a Q&A tab, and you can type your questions once you start hearing, but it can be done at any time and also in the formal part of the Q&A session. If the presentation at any stage gets covered by the speaker window, you have two options. You can hold the window and move it around to a convenient part of the screen, or if you click the camera icon, the window will get minimized. I now invite Rear Admiral R.J. Nadkarni to deliver the first Admiral J.G. Nadkarni Memorial Lecture. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Vice Admiral Karve, patron of the Maritime History Society, Commodore Johnson, Director MHS, all officers and MHS members and staff watching this from wherever you are. A very good afternoon to all of you. I feel privileged to have been invited to give this talk with the MHS, and especially because this particular MHS Monsoon Musings is meant to honor my late father, a former Chief of Naval Staff as well as patron of the MHS, Admiral J.G. Nadkarni. Some of the older or more senior amongst you must be aware that my father was one of the foremost navigators of his time. Since I followed in his footsteps, I thought that it would be apt to make the theme of this talk Navigation Methods of Ancient Mariners. While the MHS had originally wished me to speak on Indian nautical knowledge, I felt that it would be more meaningful if I discussed navigation methods that had originated in other parts of the world too, while giving a special focus to Indian seafarers. I acknowledge a number of sources from where I have obtained the research material for this talk, but in particular, I am indebted to the late Professor B. Arunachalam, the doyen of Indian maritime heritage and navigation and author of a number of books on this subject, who along with Vice Admiral Awati, the founder, as well as my father, were the driving force behind the MHS for almost 40 years. So without further ado, let me begin. Today we know with a good deal of certainty that the Earth is a spherical planet whose surface is about 71% of water, and of this water about 96.5% is contained in the oceans. Further, the earth rotates on its axis once in 24 hours, which gives us day and night, and also revolves around the sun in just over 365 days, which gives us the seasons of the year. The earth is also the third planet in the solar system and the only inhabitable planet. But thousands of years ago, man thought that the world was flat, and if one traveled far enough, ships would actually fall off the edge and possibly be eaten by huge sea monsters. It was a Greek astronomer and mathematician, Eratosthenes, who in around 240 BC was the first to calculate the circumference of the earth, and that too quite accurately, though there is some controversy about the length of the stadia that he was using for the measurement. However, it was only in 1522, after circumnavigation by the Magellan expedition, that a majority of people came to believe that the earth was round. Now, of course, astronauts can see it for themselves from space. An even more rigid belief of our ancestors was that the earth was the center of the universe, around which the sun and planets circled, known as a geocentric theory, and especially supported by astronomers such as Ptolemy. However, it was a Polish astronomer, Nicholas Copernicus, who in 1543 first postulated that it was the sun and not the earth which was at the center of the solar system. Despite this and subsequent proofs by reputed astronomers, notably Galileo and Kepler, the dogmatic Catholic Church refused to believe it, declaring it as heresy. It was only in the 17th century when renowned scientists such as Isaac Newton also endorsed the heliocentric theory that it came to be universally accepted. Our earliest ancestors had very little knowledge about the sea. All they could see was a mass of water which stretched out before them, which with no end in sight and no knowledge of what lay on the other side. So why did they still venture forth? I would like to ascribe it to a number of reasons. The most obvious being gathering food or fishing, trading to discover new lands, perhaps it was migration or conquest of new territories that they had found. But in venturing forth, all these intrepid seamen still needed to have some way of knowing what is today commonly referred to as PCS, or position, course, and speed. Today, we have a number of technological marvels which enable us in real time to know this PCS as well as communicate with anyone anywhere in the world. But our ancestors were not so fortunate. So what did they have? Well, to start with, many things that are still available to us even today. Firstly, the celestial bodies, primarily the sun and stars and the moon, were there in the day and night sky for them to see. Familiar objects on the coastline could be used as landmarks. They also understood the concept of prevailing winds. Our forefathers had keenly developed senses to pick up even small changes in the environment around them. Despite having only rudimentary tools, our ancestors were able to invent some remarkable navigation instruments. Some mariners also carried birds with them on long voyages. If the birds, when released, flew around the vessel in circles, it meant that there was no land in sight. However, if they flew off in a certain direction, then it was quite likely that land was in that direction. They also had very good powers of observation and recording what they saw in the form of maps, charts, sailing directions, and logs. But most importantly, our ancestors showed great application of mind in using the tools available to them in the best possible way. Our ancestors have used the sea for thousands of years, as can be seen from this slide. These include ancient civilizations such as the Indus Valley, as well as the seafaring communities such as the Polynesians. Let us now see some of the sea routes that ancient mariners followed in the past. In all probability, the earliest seafarers initially stayed close to the coast, and it was only after they gained confidence in their seamanship and navigation skills that they dared to venture into the great unknown, ocean. While coastal navigation does have obvious advantages, it has its share of challenges too. These are changeable winds, adverse weather more likely to be experienced close to coast, strong tidal streams and eddies at the mouths of harbors and rivers, currents and drifts of varying direction and character, and finally, underwater dangers such as shoals and reefs and risk of foundering, especially during rough weather. The more remarkable voyages made by ancient mariners are, however, no doubt the oceanic voyages. Amongst the first such intrepid mariners were the Polynesians, who are believed to have originated in modern-day Taiwan and reached Samoa and Tonga as early as 1200 BCE. From there, they fanned out to the Cook Islands as early as 300 AD, eventually heading to the Hawaiian Islands between 400 and 600 AD. Later on, around 1200 AD, the Polynesians again crossed the ocean and settled in what is now known as New Zealand. Sea trade between the people of the Indian subcontinent with their maritime neighbors is believed to have begun in the 3rd millennium BCE. These trade routes became more established with time and connected India with Southeast Asia, Arabia, and East Africa. Seafarers made extensive use of the monsoon winds for planning voyages, with westward voyages undertaken during the northeast monsoon and eastward voyages during the southwest monsoon wind, which was named Hippalus, supposedly after the Greek navigator who discovered that this wind could be used to sail a direct route from the Red Sea to India. No talk on ancient navigation can be complete without a mention of the periplus of the Erythraean Sea. This was a Greco-Roman periplus, or a kind of logbook, written by an unknown author in the 1st century AD or CE that describes navigation and trading opportunities between Roman Egyptian ports in the Red Sea and ports in the Indian Ocean. The two most famous ports in India, which are regularly mentioned in the periplus, are Bharat Gaza, which is likely to be in modern-day Bharuch, and Muziris, which was originally believed to be Kodagulur, but may actually be Pattanam. The port of Muziris has been depicted in this copy of a map of the road and trade route of the network of the Roman Empire, which existed till about 400 CE. While the voyages undertaken in the Arabian Sea were almost entirely for trade, the Cholas of South India undertook maritime expeditions to Sri Lanka, as well as parts of Southeast Asia across the Bay of Bengal for military conquest and spreading the religious and cultural influence in these lands. Both Rajaraja and Rajendra Chola undertook major expeditionary voyages to Lanka, Kadaram, that is Malaya, Sri Vijaya and Indonesia, and Pegu, which is now in Myanmar. During the 15th century, the Chinese Yunnan Admiral Zheng He undertook 7 treasure voyages to Southeast Asia, the Indian subcontinent, Arabia, the Red Sea, and parts of East Africa. However, these were not the first Chinese voyages to the Indian Ocean as such. Those had started during the Han Dynasty, which is between 200 BC to 200 AD. Next. Can I have the next slide? A very significant voyage for us to remember is that taken by Vasco da Gama in discovering the sea route from Europe to India in 1498. After reaching the Cape of Good Hope, da Gama sailed further up the coast of East Africa till he reached Malindi, which is in present-day Kenya. There he met the Omani navigator Ahmed ibn Majid, whom he persuaded to guide the Portuguese ships across the Indian Ocean to Calicut, which he reached on the 17th of May 1498. The first circumnavigation of the Earth was undertaken by a Spanish expedition organized by the Portuguese explorer, Ferdinand Magellan. Ironically, Magellan was not supported by his own king, Manuel I of Portugal, in undertaking the expedition, and it was King Charles I of Spain who funded it. Unfortunately, Magellan himself could not complete the circumnavigation, as he was killed during a battle with the natives while in the Philippines. At the time, Magellan got no recognition and was in fact reviled by his native Portugal for having sailed under the flag of Spain. But today, this first circumnavigation has been called the greatest sea voyage in the age of discovery and even the most important maritime voyage ever undertaken. Lastly, no talk about the great explorers is complete without mentioning the voyages. Next slide, please. Without mentioning the voyages of Captain James Cook, the 18th century explorer, navigator, and surveyor, whose achievements in mapping the Pacific, New Zealand, and Australia over the course of three epic voyages radically changed Western perceptions of world geography. Unfortunately, like Magellan, Cook was killed on the island of Hawaii by local natives on his last voyage. Cook is also remembered for two other feats. Firstly, proving the reliability of the marine chronometer, and secondly, for overcoming scurvy by feeding his sailors fresh fruit and vegetables and lemon juice whenever he could. So while sailing along these oceanic routes, how were these ancient mariners able to solve a PCS question? First and foremost, they made extensive use of celestial bodies, primarily the sun during the day and the stars at night. As is well known now, stars have certain characteristics. All heavenly bodies, including stars, rise in the east and set in the west in an approximate time span of 12 hours. They have a maximum transit altitude during this time, which depends on the observer's latitude and the declination of the star, that is, a angular distance north or south of the equator. Each star is visible in the night sky for about 6 months of the year. The azimuth of each star is the same all the year round. And the most important star for navigation is the pole star, because its altitude can be used directly to find a latitude. Unfortunately, the pole star is not always visible or conspicuous, particularly in southern latitudes. In that case, the transit altitude of other prominent stars in its vicinity, such as in the Ursa Major constellation, can also be used to give the approximate latitude if you know their angular distance from the pole star. Just like the stars, the sun also has certain well-defined but different characteristics. Its azimuth varies according with the time of the year, because as we know, its declination varies from 23.5 degrees north to 23.5 degrees south. And secondly, the altitude of the sun at Merpas can also be used to find latitude if the observer knows the declination of the sun. So ancient mariners used stars which were close to the horizon to steer a steady course for about 2 hours each during the rise and set. Now we know that stars rise and set about 4 minutes earlier each day. So a specific star can only be used for 2 months in a year. That is, 1 month during the time of rising and 1 month during the setting. Consequently, each night, about 5 to 6 identified horizon stars were necessary for course keeping for these mariners. And as mentioned earlier, the pole star can also be used for calculating the latitude. The Polynesian seafarers had made star compasses using different shapes and sizes of seashells to indicate the azimuth of prominent stars that could be used for giving a direction at sea. And some of the stars which they used are shown on the left. Similarly, Indian seafarers too had mapped many other stars that could be used for navigation. So each community, whether it was the Gujaratis or whether that was the Kachis or whether it was the Lakshadweep Islanders or whether it was the Tamils, called them by different names. So each community had made some kind of a star compass, and this is a photo of a Kachi ready reckoner star compass, actual photograph. And if you come to the next slide, please. Now this is a transliterated version. So as you can see, this has made use of a total of 32 horizon stars, which are shown on the outer circle. And used on this, the mariners could not only get the azimuth which they required to follow, but using the azimuth, the direction of the north star, that is the pole star, and the direction of the stars that they used for getting the azimuth, they could also work out what was a departure, which is essentially the distance which is made good on the east-west direction when traveling along the rumbling course. So using this particular ready reckoner, they could get many parameters, and based on that, they could work out what would be the dead reckoning on a particular rumbling course. Similarly, the Lakshadweep Islanders also had used the ready reckoner, which was something of a cross between a slide rule and the Norris tables, which we all studied when we were in NDE school, especially for traverse sailing, because that time from the course and the distance, you had to first calculate the departure as a distance sine course, then work out the D lat, that is the distance cos course, then work out the mean lat, which was the average of the two latitudes, and based on that, then work out what's the D long. So the islanders were just able to use this compass or this circle and work it out without really having to go through that entire process. And also, if the coordinates of the ports of departure, just last slide, go back to the last slide. If the coordinates of the ports of departure and arrival were known, then they could also find out the distance to be covered and the course to be steered. So for example, the coordinates of known ports, if they were to use those values and then work out the difference in longitude and difference in latitude, then using this particular reckoner, they could immediately get the course and the distance that it would take. Next slide. Now, Indian and Arab navigators had also measured and recorded the altitude of the pole star, which was known as the cow to the seamen of South India and the Lakshadweep, and the dhruv or dhruv to Kachis for various locations on the coast as well as the island. And then made out a list of such altitudes for various positions. So some of these altitudes for major places are shown in the table on the left, which are in the figure called Viral, which will be explained to you a little later, but it essentially is a measure of angular distance. Now for Tamil seamen, particularly the Chola expeditionaries, the pole star was either too low in the horizon or too dim to be useful for navigation. In its place, they relied upon a star which was known as Arundhati to them, which is very close to the Ursa Major constellation. And similarly to the Dhruv tables, they had made tables for Arundhati, which were for again made out for various locations, both within India as well as for locations in Southeast Asia. As far as time was concerned, ancient Indian seafarers measured time in a unit called Naligai, where one Naligai was approximately 24 minutes and 64 Naligai made a mean day. And distance was measured in either Yaman or Zaman, which was shortened to Zam, where one Zam was a mean distance sailed during a single boat voyage of 3 hours or about 7.5 Naligai. Now one Zaman corresponded to approximately 12 miles in terms of distance. And during the day, a vessel would have sailed approximately 100 miles in a day of 8 Zamans. So as you can see, a lot of approximations were used. But nevertheless, they had kept a record of sailing distances of these Zamans, maybe assimilated over a long period of time, firstly between the islands and the mainland in terms of Zamans, and also of more distance sea routes, such as those which were made by them to Arabia as well as Africa. So having seen some of the ways that mariners use celestial navigation, let us now explore some of the ingenious instruments which they had devised for navigation. Firstly, the magnetic compass, which is believed to have been invented more than 2000 years ago. The first compasses were made of lodestone, a naturally magnetized stone in China during the Han Dynasty. However, these compasses were used not for navigation originally, but for divination, that is to find the future. It was during the Song dynasty that the use of the compass for navigation was actually realized. And later compasses were made of iron needles called lodestone, and the iron was magnetized by rubbing them with the lodestone. The magnetic compass first appeared in Europe in the 12th century CE. There were two types, that is a floating compass for astronomical purposes and a dry compass for navigation. It is not clear whether the Europeans learned of the compass from the Chinese or they discovered it independently. The earliest reference to a compass in the Arab or Muslim world occurs in 1232. Late in the 13th century, the use of the compass was described as a Qibla indicator to find the direction to Mecca, which was much more important to Muslims. As regards Indian seafarers, a magnetic compass is mentioned in 4th century Tamil nautical books. It consisted apparently of a fish-shaped magnet floating in a bowl fixed with oil, which is why it was probably called Matsya Yantra. And a reference to this is also to be found in the British Bombay Gazetteer, Volume 13, Part 2, which was published in 1882, an extract of which is shown on the slide. One of the most important requirements of ancient navigators was to measure angular distance, both in the vertical as well as the horizontal plane. The Polynesians were masters and very adept at using only their hand, as this illustration shows. Ancient Indian and Arab seafarers also made use of the hand and fist to measure angular distance. In that case, the basic use of angular measurement, as I mentioned, was a finger unit, which was called the viral in the south and the anguli in the north and the isba by Arab seamen. A finger unit is the distance between the two knuckles of the middle finger of an adult and is equal to about 3/4 of an inch. Using this unit, the angular distance between the end knuckles of the closed fist, which is held horizontally at the distance of a stretched arm, is equal to about 4 virals. Similarly, a closed fist held vertically with the thumbs up gives an angular distance of 12 virals. And in terms of equivalence in angular and linear distance, 1 viral is equivalent to about 8 zam, that is about 1 degree 36 minutes of arc. As regards man-made instruments, the cross staff was one of the earliest which could be used to measure angles. It consisted of a pole or a main staff which was marked with graduations for length. The cross piece or the transom slides up and down on the main staff. The transom is adjusted so that its lower edge is on the horizon and the upper edge is in line with the heavenly body. Obviously, it was not easy to look directly at the sun, and hence the back staff was invented. Users kept the sun at their back and observed the shadow cast by the upper vane on the horizon vane. Ancient Indian mariners had a very similar instrument such as the cross backstaff. Next slide, please. This was called the Kol Palagai, and it was used mainly by the Lakshadweep seafarers. It had 3 fixed positions. They were called the cow kutti or the star side. This is from where the observer is looking. Then the neer kutti, which is the water side, and the Nizar Kutti, or the shadow side. The observer looked through a slit in the cow kutti to get the shadow of the sun through a Nizar Kutti as projected in the Neer Kutti. The Neer Kutti also helped to get the instrument aligned with the horizon. The seagoing astrolabe was a simple circular brass disc with a degree scale, a ring from which to suspend it freely, and a rotable alidate carrying sighting pinules. The user sights the star through the pinules and reads the star's altitude from the scale. For a sun sight, the alidate is adjusted so that a ray of sunlight passing through a hole in the upper vane falls precisely on the hole in the lower vane. The mariner's quadrant which is a quarter of a circle made of either wood or brass, came into widespread use for navigation around 1450 CE. But it had two major limitations. Firstly, it was hard to keep exactly vertical in the plane of a heavenly body on a rolling and pitching ship. And it was even more difficult to keep the wind from blowing the plumb bob offline. The Arab seafarers had developed a more advanced version of the quadrant, which was called the Rubul Mujayab, which not only measured the altitude, but also could be used to find the time of day, give the direction to Mecca, and daily time of prayer. It was similar in shape to the European quadrant and also had a plumb bob. The two holes on the upper side could be used to sight the star. In case of the sun, the two holes had to be aligned in such a way so that a dot was produced on the observer's finger. Once the holes were aligned, the observer held the plumb bob firmly against the quadrant and read off the altitude on the circular scale. Lakshadweep seafarers used a quadrant known as the Vattapalagai, probably derived from the Arab Rubul Mujayab, which could also perform similar functions. Toward the late 1600s and early 1700s, the more inventive instrument makers shifted to optical systems based on mirrors and prisms that could be used to observe celestial bodies. The first octant was independently and almost simultaneously made by John Handy in England and Thomas Godfrey, a Philadelphia glazier, in around 1731. The fundamental idea was to use two mirrors to make a doubly reflecting instrument, the forerunner of the modern sextant. So, whereas an octant could measure angles up to 90 degrees and is ideally suited for observations of celestial body above the horizons, greater angular measurement is needed for lunar distance observations. But it was a very simple matter to enlarge the octant, which is an eighth of a circle, to a sextant, which is a sixth of a circle. And principle has remained virtually the same. Sextants have become lighter with the use of composite materials and with a higher degree of accuracy. Just to digress a little, of all my father's navigational abilities, possibly the one for which he is most remembered is that of sight taking, especially rapid sights. This is an extract of his midshipman sight book, which he had donated to ND School just a few years back, and they had uploaded on the website, which is there for all to see. And as the director had mentioned, I had undertaken this voyage on the INSV Samudra in 1989, and as luck would have it, I managed to dig out an old photograph of me taking a sight when I was sailing the South Pacific on board. We did not carry a GPS on board like is almost common today, and this was the only way to navigate from one island to the other. Coming back to my presentation, the Arabs used an instrument which was known as the Kamal to measure angular distance, which is likely to have been invented in the late 9th century. Ahmed ibn Majid, the Omani navigator who guided Vasco da Gama from the east coast of Africa to Calicut, used the Kamal extensively. Indian seafarers of South India and the Lakshadweep used an instrument similar to the Arab Kamal called the Rapapalagai. However, instead of one, it had two rectangular boards, one small and one big, which were at either end of a long string that was knotted at specific distances. The string was held between the teeth, as shown by Professor Arunachal himself in this photo, at the appropriate knot position, and the board extended at arm's length so that the lower rim met the horizon and the upper edge aligned with a star. The boards also had graduations on the side to measure fractional cow values. Using this instrument, next slide please. Using this instrument, the seaman could find out if he was north, south, or on the correct latitude of a particular port depending on the positional star with respect to the upper rim, as you can see in the illustration at the bottom. Another instrument which was used by Indian seafarers was a cow kutti, which operated on the principle similar to the cross staff. It consisted of a slender, long wooden rod with a handle at one end and a sliding wooden rider at the other, which could be moved closer or further away to obtain the desired angle. The rod was blue and indicated the angular measurement in virals. Measurement of time is one of the most important requirements of a mariner at sea, in terms of both the time of the day as well as the time span of events, such as for keeping the duration of a watch or for estimation of speed. The second requirement, which is the easier one, was not so difficult to overcome. And one of the most common instruments used by the earliest mariners was the hourglass, which could use either sand or water. But finding the time of day was much more difficult, and it gave rise to what became known as the longitude question. So while the estimation or calculation of latitude was known to both astronomers as well as mariners for centuries, the same could not be said for longitude till the 18th century. It was known to people that finding longitude was based on knowing the local time at the observer's location very precisely and comparing it with the time at a standard location, such as a meridian of Greenwich. Finding the time at the observer's local position is not very difficult. It is the time at which Merault occurs. But how do you find what time it is at Greenwich? Because the clocks of that era were very inaccurate and unable to withstand the hard and punishing environment that existed on board ships at sea. Ships were therefore forced to depend largely on dead reckoning for days on end, which led to a number of ships running aground and foundering, leading to loss of life. And especially notable is that of a British squadron which was returning from a campaign overseas, which ran aground on the Scilly Isles, resulting in the foundering of some 5 ships and the loss of something like 2,000 seamen, including the admiral commanding that squadron, Admiral Shovel. This led to the British Parliament passing an act on the 8th of July 1714, which formed the Board of Longitude, offering a reward of £20,000 to anyone who could determine time the most accurately. So one of the methods proposed was by the English astronomer Reverend Dr. Neville Maskelyne, that of measuring lunar distance, that is between the moon and another celestial body. This angular distance, which was used in conjunction with the nautical almanac, could be the British time, and the local time could then be calculated by solving a spherical triangle. This method was feasible, and actually it was used till the middle of the 19th century, was extremely cumbersome and time consuming. But one spin-off of this method, though ultimately it did not prove to be of a long duration, was that it gave rise to the institution of the Nautical Almanac, which was first published in 1767, in which the lunar distances as well as many other astronomical parameters were published. But it was John Harrison who came up with a much more practical and quicker solution. Harrison, who was a self-educated English carpenter and clockmaker, is today acknowledged as the inventor of the marine chronometer after devoting almost his entire life to this pursuit. He designed 4 clocks named as H1 to H4. The first 3 were large clocks, probably the most accurate clocks in the world at that time, but which unfortunately could not withstand the extreme environment encountered at sea, particularly due to the motion of the ship. However, it was H4, which was designed in the shape of a wheel and which, instead of a pendulum, made use of a balance wheel, which proved to be the game changer. This chronometer was embarked on a ship, which was then sailed to the island of Barbados in the West Indies, reached about 81 days later, where it was found to have lost a net time of just 5 seconds, which corresponds with accuracy about 1 nautical mile. The reliability and accuracy of the chronometer made by Harrison was indisputably validated when a copy of the H4 design made by Larkin Kendall called K1 was used by Captain James Cook during his second and third voyages in the Pacific on HMS Resolution. Cook's log is full of praise for the watch and the charts of the South Pacific which he made, which we'll see a little later, were remarkably accurate. Now, traditionally, Indian navigation methods could not find longitude directly, as like the rest of the civilized world, no method of accurate timekeeping had been discovered. However, they were aware of this phenomenon of convergence of meridians towards the poles, and Indian navigators were thus able to estimate departure by sailing the rum line courses and use this to obtain an accurate dead reckoning position. To do this, they used a measure which was known as TIRFA, that is the distance sailed by a vessel on a fixed bearing or a course northwards to raise its latitude or stellar altitude by one finger or viral. The course was expressed in terms of nakhat and the length of the route in terms of zams. The more a vessel diverged from the north-south direction, the more it had to cover in terms of TIRFA, and the corresponding increase in stellar latitude was measured in virals. Using this knowledge, navigators such as the Kutchis had created ready reckoners in the form of stellar azimuth circles to estimate distances which they would need to cover on courses of the north-south. For example, in this illustration, the navigator would have to cover a TIRFA of about 11 zams while using Saptarshi as the azimuth star, Saptarshi being the constellation of Ursa Major, compared to Dhruv. Indian and Arab navigators, also independently of each other, had compiled departure tables. As you can see, they are very close to each other up to 6 compass points, that is in the direction of east northeast, west northwest, but then they start to diverge. Of the Chola values, as you can make out, are the closest to the actual. Sailors of South India also used an instrument called the Adi Kanakku or foot measure, which was to estimate the time of day based on the length of a shadow. And this time was measured in units of Naligai. The shadow cast by the mast post, stem post, or even a person or pole erected on deck was measured and compared to the object length to estimate the time elapsed in sunrise or two elapse till sunset. During the night, the time of rising or setting of the moon in relation to the tithi, that is the day reckoned with reference to the last full or new moon day, and the elevation of the moon served as useful indicators of time. In the Western world, measurement of speed during the days of sail was done during a chip log. It was replaced only in the last century by modern logs such as the pitometer, the Czernicki for the impeller, and the electromagnetic log. In the chip log, the sailor rocks the log over the ship's stern where it acts as a drogue while the vessel moves away. The sailor then lets the log line run out for a fixed time while counting the knots that pass through his hands, which correspond to the speed. The knot, the word knot, derives from this method. Next slide. Indian seafarers use an instrument similar to the chip log, which was known as the Tappu Palagai, where the knotted line was paid out for a time duration of 15 or 30 seconds, measured by a sand glass. A calculation table known as the Tappu Kanakku was used to work out the speed based on the time taken and the knots paid out. The early estimation of depth was based on the discoloration of the sea, as well as the sounds of the waves breaking on the coast or on a shallow reef. But the most common method of measuring depth in the age of sail was using a hand-written line, a practice which is followed even today in certain circumstances. Indian mariners used two instruments for measuring depth, the first being a sounding pole, which was used in shallower waters, and the second, a similar hand net line called by various names for use in deep waters. And the unit for depth was known as bomb. Once out at sea, seafarers had to deal with the vagaries of wind, weather and current, just as they do today. But in their case, they were much more exposed to the elements and less sure about what to expect. Seasonal winds were therefore used as a fairly reliable direction indicator. Seamen realized or recognized that winds flow steadily over months from a fairly constant direction, and that sailing during a particular season would give them the best winds to take them to their destination quickly and safely. Ancient Indian seafarers, such as the Lakshadweep Islanders, had prepared seasonal wind roses for various coastal regions. Similarly, Kachi and Tamil seafarers had also made wind compasses with the names of winds corresponding to those expected in different seasons. Seafarers were also aware of ocean currents. For estimating the current, they used a moist ball of grey wood ash thrown into the sea from the amaram or the stern and observed as it slowly diffused and formed a linear flow pattern. Nirmayam indicated a chaotic white dispersal. Let us now see how the world was mapped and charted by ancient astronomers, explorers and geographers. Nautical charts and written descriptions of sea and coastal areas, now known as sailing directions, have also been in use in one form or the other since the 6th century BCE. The Polynesians created so-called stick charts consisting of thin strips of coconut frond bound together in straight or curved lines using coconut fiber to create a frame-like structure. At various places in the frame, small seashells were tied together by creating junctions using two or more sticks. The curved sticks show where swells are deflected by an island. The short straight strips indicate currents near islands. The longer strips may indicate the direction in which certain islands are to be found, and the small cowrie shells represent the islands themselves. Unlike other maps and charts, stick charts are not a literal representation of the ocean area, but more an abstract illustration of the way that ocean swells interact with land. Indeed, individual charts vary so much in form and interpretation that often a stick chart can only be read by the person who made it. The charts were also not used for navigation as we use maps or charts today. Seldom did sailors carry the charts with them when they made their journeys, and instead, navigators memorized the chart prior to the journey and then used the senses and memory to guide them. Other than the Polynesians, the earliest known world maps date back to antiquity, the oldest examples being from the 6th century BCE. World maps assuming a spherical Earth first appear in the Hellenistic period, that is between the 4th and the 1st century BCE. The developments of Greek geography by Aristophanes and Posidonius culminated in Ptolemy's world map first published in the 2nd century CE, which would remain the most authoritative throughout the Middle Ages. Various versions of Ptolemy's world map continue to remain in vogue till as late as the 15th century, as this one by Nicholas Germanus shows, as well as this one by Johannes Schnichter. In 1154, a Moroccan geographer, Muhammad al-Idrisi, incorporated the knowledge of Africa, the Indian Ocean and the Far East, gathered by Arab merchants and explorers, with the information inherited from classical geographers, to create the most accurate of the world at that time, which was known as the Tabula Rogerinia. Maps were also used by the Chinese admiral Zheng He during his special voyages to the Indian Ocean, one of which is shown as transliterated. But undoubtedly, the most important figure in the history of cartography is Gerardus Mercator. He is most renowned for creating the 1569 world map based on the new projection, which now bears his name, and represented courses of constant bearing or rumb lines as straight lines, a technique that is still employed in nautical charts. Mercator also produced over 100 new regional maps in a smaller format with which he planned to publish his atlas. Unfortunately, he died before he could finish his task, which was completed by his son in 1595. Notably, both the 1569 map and the 1595 atlas include North and South America. However, Australia was still unknown till 1606, when it was discovered by European explorers. The man responsible for surveying Australia and New Zealand and a large part of the Pacific with remarkable navigation accuracy for his time was Captain James Cook, whose three voyages over the course of 12 years contributed much to Europeans' knowledge of the area. However, Cook was helped by a Tahitian navigator, Tupaia, who he took along with him during his first voyage. This slide shows the map prepared by Tupaia, the locations of the Pacific Islands, which then Cook used to carry out their survey. Consequent to the discovery of the sea route from Europe to India by Vasco da Gama, the Portuguese charted much of the subcontinent's coastline, which is one such chart of the 16th century shown here. With the advent of other European colonial powers, more detailed charts of the coastline as well as the islands of the coast of India were published. Yeah, okay. So these were the charts which are made by Europeans in around the 18th and some in the 19th century as well. Next. So what about our indigenous seafarers? Till recently, there was little evidence that they relied on nautical charts as did the Europeans, Chinese and Arabs. However, some charts used by Kachi navigators have now come to light. These are not geographically accurate, and appear to be more in the form of line drawings of coastal features, panorama sketches of limited voyages of the coast as observed from sea. The chart on this slide depicts a part of the southern coast of modern-day Karnataka, with stellar bearings taken from an offshore island. The pole star altitude of one place on the coast is shown. There are a number of features shown, including the skyline profile of a hill ridge, small islands offshore, palm trees, shallow waters, and the presence of underwater reefs, shoals, and banks. This is another Kachi chart of Kanyakumari and Sri Lanka, which again shows similar features of the coastline as observed from sea. Next. This is the original print of a Kachi chart of the Arabian coast and the Red Sea. And the next slide would show a little more detail. Next slide. Yeah, we have shown a little inset. The chart is not geographically accurate as you would obviously make out. It's in a linear format, but it shows port and island locations which are there on to be found on either side, together with their pole star latitudes and stellar azimuths. It also identifies some places by name. At one end is Socotra and at the other end is Jeddah. Some Maratha maps of coastal areas have also been found, such as this one of the South Konkan coast. Next. And this one of the Malwan Taluka. And this one is of Vijayadurg Taluka. However, these have very limited navigational value and are meant mainly for demarcating land areas for the revenue administration. In this last part of the presentation, we shall see some navigation records maintained by ancient navigators. Sorry. Besides the legendary anonymous author of the Periplus, several Arab and European navigators compiled detailed logs and navigational treatises based on the voyages undertaken by them, such as the Kitab al-Fawaid by Ibn Majid and this captain's log of the HMS Endeavour by James Cook. Unlike European and Arab seafarers, there is a smaller body of recorded knowledge amongst ancient Indians. This is probably because of the lack of interaction between the ruling upper caste and the lower caste seamen, and the desire of the latter to give their sea wisdom and knowledge of skills to themselves. This wisdom was considered cherished knowledge that had to be safeguarded against its spread among potential rivals. Much of the sea wisdom is therefore knowledge inherited from previous generations and passed on to the next generation through time. Also, whatever knowledge has been put down in writing is in local coastal dialects, more phonetic rather than literary. Some indigenous manuals that do exist were used by the Lakshadweep and Kutchi seafarers, which are known as Ramonis and Pothis respectively. While these have not been very well written, probably because the authors were not very literate, they do have considerable amount of valuable navigation and empirical data. For example, the star chart and use of various star symbols to guide seafarers, which are contained in the Pothi. And this Pothi, which contains illustrations of landmarks to identify various locations on the coast of the Gulf of Aden and the Red Sea. In conclusion, ancient mariners, even without all the modern technology and range of navigation aids that we possess today, were able to sail the world's oceans safely and accurately. True, they faced many dangers, such as uncharted shoals and reefs, raging storms, and a fear of the unknown. But over the course of centuries, indeed millennia, they were able to build up a vast body of knowledge about celestial bodies, characteristics of the coastline of places and ports of interest, routes to be followed, environmental conditions, especially wind conditions. And from this knowledge and their own powers of invention, create some truly remarkable navigational instruments to aid them on their passage. Today, we live in a world where we are very much dependent on technology. For those in the audience who are themselves mariners, you must be aware that we cannot take this technology for granted, and that in the event of a war, satellites may be destroyed, radio links disrupted, and cyber attacks launched to target our computer networks. To still be able to navigate safely under these conditions, we must therefore continue to remain in date and practice our skills at basics, particularly visual and celestial navigation. While I'm not advocating the use of birds as a rapa palagai, certainly we need to practice such skills as taking sights and visual fixes regularly, else we may be found wanting when the situation requires us to display these skills. With that, I've finished and would be glad to take on any questions that you may have. Thank you.
Thank you, Admiral, for what everyone will agree is a fantastic, vast scope of covering from ancient practices to connecting it with some of the things that we have done in our early days of navigation. And even as you set up the question answers, we already have about 6 or 7 that have come. And then the new ones I will try and incorporate. What I'm going to do, sir, is I'm going to combine some of the questions because they relate to similar things. And let me put in sequence, there's many queries which talk about documentary evidences of some of the things in past, and I'll kind of combine them into one. So there is this question about, for example, which came at the end, we have understanding and knowledge of Indians having done voyages, including a voyage about Bindusar sending Ashoka on a sea voyage from Kaling to Indus. Similarly, when we talk of nautical publications and documents, the question is, how old do we have publications? To what century BC? And are some of these, or to which era do these belong? So I think the question that is combined is, what degree of antiquity do we have documentary or confirmed evidences of this voyage apart from what is available in literary sources? So your response, sir. That's I'm combining 2-3 questions.
So I think, as you rightly said, there are a number of mentions of such voyages in many of our old books, such as the Vedas, the Puranas, and indeed the epics. And these go back many thousands of years, as I'm sure the audience would be aware. But in those, we find there is not much mention of the navigational techniques. Certainly, we know that the ancients of those days also would have been aware of the stars, the nakshatra, which they certainly would have used. As I mentioned in my talk, the earliest recorded history of navigation per se exists from the Indus Valley times, that's about 3000 BCE. So from that era roughly, we have definite navigation evidence as well, which is there in the form of tablets and in the form of certain artifacts which are shown in the archaeological findings. Similarly, in the books that I mentioned, there are references to voyages which have been undertaken by some of the ancient kingdoms, some of the, you can say the people who lived in India at that time, whether it was between places on mainland India or whether it was to neighboring countries. But insofar as the navigational methods are concerned, there are few references to them. Though, like I said, references to use of stars for navigation certainly existed. I'm sure that people would have known about stars such as the pole star. Though many people in the audience would be aware that the Earth also has not always pointed to the pole star, that we call the pole star today, Polaris. Because the Earth, in fact, rotates, or you can say wobbles, it axis wobbles in a motion which is called precession. And it wobbles once every 26,000 years. So it is actually changing, the Earth's axis is pointing its direction or changing its direction very, very infinitesimally every year, you can say. And that's why, like I said, in passing in one of the celestial navigation slides, that the declination of the star, though we take it as almost the same every day, but it's actually changing fractionally, very marginally, which is almost, you can say, negligible. But it does take place, and that's why in the days when the Vedas and the Puranas were written, it is quite possible that other constellations were there where the Earth's axis was pointing to, instead of where it is pointing to now. Okay. I'm quite sure that many of the techniques which later generations of seafarers followed, particularly celestial navigation, the more ancient navigators would also have followed.
Thank you, sir. In fact, I will, before we have the formal closing remarks, we'll comment on some of these things. I just want to take this time before the next question. There have been a lot of questions that have come off. Where do you find these old artifacts? And apart from MHS, the question is, where else would you see? So I just want to mention that there are very, very few live evidences, like Ra Palagai was one of the things that Professor Arunachalam personally cited. Commander Mohan Narayan is unfortunately in the audience, but in many other components, we have instruments, but they are more of descriptions, and in many places they are kind of depictions. So unfortunately, museum evidences are very low. But there's a question that they have said is, many shipwreck observations from which we derive our old navigational knowledge are in the West. And the question is there anything specific in terms of Indian shipwrecks which have enhanced our knowledge of navigational practices?
Well, obviously, shipwrecks tell you that where a reef or a shoal which was previously unknown, it comes to light at that point of time. So I think shipwrecks over many centuries, many millennia, it has helped geographers, cartographers, even seafarers to chart the oceans better. And we have descriptions which are there to say that in the past, especially in the Periplus, for example, it talks about when navigating between the Red Sea and various ports on the Indian subcontinent, when mariners are to approach a coast, then it guides them in a way so as to avoid dangers. So certainly, initially when seafarers started out, they would have been much more unsure of where the dangers lay. But with the passage of time and obviously a process of trial and error over many centuries, and as many of these shipwrecks, like I was mentioned, took place, they came to know more and more about which were the dangerous waters and which were the navigable or the safer waters. And thereby they created routes which they built on, and they became the established routes for future generations of navigators?
Obviously, sir, there have been a lot of comments and questions complimenting this wide coverage, and that is very important because navigation is probably too vast in its scope in terms of components in that term. So that remains, and that is also, even as we go to the next question, I am also going to flash, I'm going to request, you will probably receive something called a poll, and if you can just click on your attendance or comment on it, that will be a very encouraging part of it. And meanwhile, sir, I'll read out a question. So while the audience clicks on the poll, it will I'll just go to the next question. Though you did mention about the difficulty of longitude and the difficulty of direction when pole star is not visible, you talked about angular measurements and that part, but there are a couple of young scholars who just want, maybe in a more simple terms, if you can't see the pole star or if you don't have a clarity, what were some options the ancient mariners had to find direction? I know you've touched it, but if you could just repeat in a line or two the basic principles.
So, pole star was used certainly for direction, for finding out the direction of the north. But like I said, they had also derived these azimuth circles, and each star every day rises in the same azimuth. There is no change, at least you know, during their lifetime, at least. Maybe over thousands of years, obviously, like I said, because of precession, that may change. But in their lifetime, certainly it rises in the and sets in the same direction. So that is set then as an azimuth star. For example, Satarshi, which is in the direction within the constellation. Ursa Major can be set at exactly maybe I think 11 and a quarter degrees or 11 and a half degrees.
Yes, yes.
So based on that, they had created these stars or stellar compasses, and in each course they had put one star which would rise exactly in that direction. And during the time of its rise, at least for about 2 hours after it had risen, it or 1 hour after it had risen, it could be used for steering. So like that, they had worked out. No, during the entire night, they would require about 5 to 6 stars on which which would be rise from the same direction. And one after the other, they would use one star, then the next star, and then the third star for steering in that particular course. But they were not able to see the pole star, and pole star in that direction can also give the latitude, because the altitude of the pole star, which is not exactly 90 degrees, it's about 89 degrees and so on. Of course, now in the nautical almanac, you can apply that correction, but to ancient navigators, it was quite useful in giving the direction of north. It also can give the latitude by measuring the altitude of the pole star. To navigators in the southern latitudes, whether they were in the southern part of India or if they were to go south of the equator, like for example the Cholas, then when the pole star became dimmer, they could use stars which were in the other bright constellations, like Ursa Major, and they used to measure the angular distance using either hand or using the instruments which they had. They knew how much the angular distance was there between, say, Ursa Major, one of the stars, and the pole star. So if they could get the altitude, say, of that particular star in Ursa Major, and they knew what was the difference in the angular distance between that star and the pole star group, then they could work out what would be the altitude of the pole star.
Yes.
If they were in the southern hemisphere, then obviously they can't do this. So then they had other stars which were possible to be used. In the southern hemisphere, of course, we have Akrut, so the Southern Cross, which can be used, but there is no specific star which points to the South Pole. But over a period of time, mariners would have created a sort of star compass even for southern latitudes, and based on that, figure out which stars were closest to the South Pole and what angular distance would that have been.
Okay. So before I come to the last as a pair of question. Obviously, we are very encouraged by everybody's response. I understand for us, very grateful to the participation. For us, it's our first experience as a webinar. Zoho is a platform which is a Chennai-based, completely Indian company, and we have experimented. I know there have been some limitations in audio which are very internet-based. This platform is completely cloud-based. So I'm also going to ask people to just rate your overall experience And while you are doing that poll, you know, I will just ask this last question, which is a pair of questions, sir. There is some mention that the oldest compass was found in the Harappan site of Lothal. Could you share a little bit about it? And also related, the rest of the things, there was a question which obvious answer is clear. Is there any evidence of radio navigation in earlier parts? Obviously, that the answer is very simple. And maybe as a summary, your closing points at the end of it, sir. So about the possibility of a compass based on the excavations at Lothal, radio navigation, and then overall closing points.
No, radio navigation, there is obviously no evidence of that.
Yes, yes.
As the compass is concerned, I mean, I have not seen through my research, again, of any mention of any artifact or any something which has been excavated, which resembles a compass at Lothal. So if the reference of that can be given to me, I would be happy to, you know, just maybe check that out. But otherwise, as I'm aware, the earliest compasses were those which were made by the Chinese based on their recognition of the property of the lodestone, which pointed in a certain direction. And subsequently, they realized that they could magnetize a piece of iron, which then also would point to the same direction. And if ancient Indians also had this knowledge, well, I mean, it's possible, because in the olden, in the ancient era also, there was a fair amount of interaction between these ancient civilizations. Like I said, Chinese came into the Indian Ocean sometime in the first millennium BC. So it was quite possible that this knowledge, either from the Indians to the Chinese or the Chinese to the Indians. But the evidence presently shows that it was the Chinese who found this compass first, the properties of compass first.
Okay, sir. Thanks. And my predecessor has confirmed Alcor or Arundhati is the pole star equivalent. We are aware of it. Professor Nachalam's work. Commander Mohan Narayan has mentioned. So before I close this Q&A part, not just our gratitude to you, my gratitude to my team for actually, we are from four different sites. We are trying to, based on our individual net connectivity, getting this. And but thank you for making it so easy. For many of you who have asked, the complete text of the talk and will be available as a part of the proceedings of the Monsoon Musings, which will be part of the October newsletter Sagardhara, and that will contain the complete paper. So if you've missed out something, we are hoping our recording has gone well, and if that happens, we will definitely upload it. So that's for the benefit of saying so. We ideally would have had, if it was an offline event, we would have brought a memento to you. But sir, we will hope for lockdown to lift, so your memento is due on us. But thank you. For the benefit of audience, I have this great honor that senior, first I encountered Admiral Ravi Natkarni because he was my general navigation instructor. So this is good. And we are neighbors now, so that's a good connect. And senior Admiral Jayant Natkarni obviously is the one who pushed me and was responsible for our book. So really, so to his great memory, we are very, MHS owes a lot, and thank you for joining. Time now, sir, to invite, and I will ask Matthew to just help connect and bring in on audio our patron, Admiral Karve, to give his closing remarks. And audience, just give me a minute. By the time, I'll ask Matthew to just check and set this up.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are, sir.
Okay, thank you. So that brings us to the end of this very fascinating talk by Admiral Natkarni, the junior Natkarni. And I must compliment him for really covering such a vast topic in the time that has been allotted to him. Many of the younger generation who are attending this seminar, I think, you know, you have got used to using the GPS, and navigation as such is not a challenge anymore for most mariners. In fact, for everybody, even landlubbers, today navigation has become the simplest of things to do because thanks to the GPS. But I must tell you that this kind of ease that we find today in navigation, whether at sea or on land, was not possible. In fact, even when we joined the Navy, and all this advancement in navigation by way of GPS and satellite navigation has been possible only in the last 20 to 30 years, not before that. And so the point here is that for nearly 2 or 3 millennia, humans have still taken to the sea despite all the challenges posed by the very rudimentary means of navigation that they had. And still, they undertook these perilous journeys, voyages out at sea, because there was that hunger in the belly to discover new lands, to find new wealth, and to spread their faith and beliefs across the world. So navigation has reached or took nearly 2 millennia to refine itself to a level where it could be accurately used for proper navigation at sea. Today's presentation has very rightly brought out all the difficulties and the inaccuracies of ancient mariners in the navigation skills that they followed. But more particularly, the question that even somebody asked in the audience as to why did Indian mariners why do we find the deficiency in record keeping by Indian mariners? And one of the reasons perhaps is that going out to sea was considered inauspicious by most Indians. And therefore, anything connected with sea, with the sea voyages, and including navigation, was therefore left to perhaps the lower castes who were not that well educated. And despite that, despite these limitations, we still have a wealth of information about the techniques used by those navigators, which has been very nicely brought out in this presentation. So that is the point, an important point that I think all of us must keep in mind. The other thing is that navigation at sea was very rudimentary, at least in the initial years. And it got momentum, or it became, or its accuracy improved only after timekeeping at sea, and therefore the longitudinal position could be accurately established, because latitude was known, because you could take, at least in the northern hemisphere, the altitude of the pole star could generally give you the latitude, which is one position line. But the second position line was the one which was difficult, and that was obtained only with the knowledge of the longitude of your position. And that could be done only if you knew the accurate time. So until the chronometer was invented, and thereafter one could establish your longitude, and thereafter it led to accurate position finding at sea, or position estimation at sea. And once that was done, then you find that charts were more reliable, your age of discovery just burst upon you, and you had the entire globe was circumnavigated in a very short period after that, in a couple of centuries. So navigation and its scientific discoveries that surround all these navigation techniques and the instruments, and especially record keeping and chart making, all of these have contributed to the advancement of humanity and the discovery of new lands in the past. Today, of course, we live in an era where navigation, we don't even think about how we will locate or know our position at sea. But that is the benefit of technology. But to all the youngsters in this seminar, I would urge you to take this on as an interest and passion, as a side interest and passion, or maybe as a hobby, to continuously pursue the old techniques of navigation, because they were indeed fascinating. And it was because of that that so many new discoveries were made in the past. So with those closing remarks, I will end over here. And before I end, let me once again heartily compliment the MHS and Commodore Johnson and his team for having so enthusiastically put together this monsoon music seminar on the web, and I urge him to continue doing this because it is a very convenient way of getting audience to attend to these discussion and these seminars and these seminars. Finally, once again, let me congratulate the speaker, Admiral Nadkarni, for having so fascinatingly brought out the history of ancient navigation and really educated all of us on the various techniques that were used in the short 1 hour that he had. Thank you, everybody, and Jai Hind.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Admiral, and your encouragement as patron. Before I hand over back to the anchor, Amrita, my apologies to a couple of my senior supporters who logged in and then got logged out, couldn't come back in. Sorry, we will try and work these things through. A few of you couldn't hear very clearly. We will work on it. It's a learning curve for us. While Amrita has got a couple of things to tell you, I must mention for the younger audience and for the older mentors that we have announced that there will be Admiral J.G. Nadkarni Memorial Essay Competition. The details will come up later, but just keep that in mind and stay connected. And I'm sorry for some of the technical glitches. Let's pray and hope connectivities and things remain well. And so back to you, Amrita.
Thank you, sir. We appreciate the presence of all the participants here today. As we close the session, we urge you to stay connected with us on the various social networking sites. We have our presence on YouTube, Instagram, as well as Twitter. You can also connect with us through our website, www.mhsindia.org. Do look forward to the upcoming essay competition. Again, an annual commemoration to Admiral J.G. Nadkarni, which will be open to students and young mariners. Further details will be shared in the social media handles and on our website as well. Let me also tell you that our next monsoon musing, titled Exploring Maritime Medium Through Literature, is scheduled on 23rd July 2020. We hope you will continue to support us. Thank you and have a good day.